Hi there! Another PrusaSlicer 2.6 Alpha video. Really? Absolutely! The upcoming PrusaSlicer 2.6 release has a whole bunch of new and improved features. The Alpha 4 gives us makers a chance to get an early view on and try them out before they become part of the final release. After watching several videos about the upcoming features, I found most of them leave out some of which I really like. Maybe because they don't have such a wow factor than the new organic supports or the cut tool improvements, but which I think deserve to be mentioned too. This video is meant to close that gap a little bit more, but also shows the already covered features, probably adding some value which was missing earlier, and how the evolution of the slicer may revolutionize how we prepare our 3D files for printing in the future, saving time, material and money. Let's get started! You can get the download for the PrusaSlicer 2.6 Alpha 4 from Prusa's GitHub page, where you also find a description of the changes made to previous Alpha versions. Check out the description of the 2.6 Alpha 2, where you get a comprehensive overview of new features, which you find in the new PrusaSlicer 2.6. When using PrusaSlicer with other than Prusa's own printers, no matter if it was a other vendor printer or a custom printer profile, you only could add three generic filament profiles for PLA, PETG and ABS during configuration. Then you had to tweak those yourself to match the properties of the filament you wanted to print with. Not a big deal, but I always found that to be tedious. I never understood why I was limited to the generic ones and always had to work out the filament settings from the ground up. I'm very excited to see the introduction of so-called template filaments. These are predefined templates for various filament types and brands which already have the most reasonable values set for the filament properties. The templates are shared among all installed printers. If you need to tweak the settings for one printer, then, as you did using the generic filament profiles, you can use one of these as a baseline. The settings are mostly optimized for Prusa printers, but I think they are really good to start with. Then save it, and you can decide if you want to save it only as a profile for the current printer or as a template for each printer which is installed. The new measurement tool comes in very handy and lets you quickly check the dimensions of a loaded model directly in your slicer. To use the tool, select your object and activate the measurement tool. Then select any two points or edges or radiuses of your model by left-clicking them, and the tool will show you the distance between them or the enclosed angle or the radius. When the little pen icon is shown next to the measured value, then you can click that and enter a new value. This will uniformly scale your model up or down to match the entered value. Nice to quickly change a value, but in reality I prefer to do that in CAD. The automatic support painter is one of the new top features of the PrusaSlicer 2.6. But before going on, it's time for a short ad from this video's sponsor, which is PCBWay. PCBWay is an industry-leading manufacturer of PCBs, providing high-quality PCBs at a low price. Besides PCBs, PCBWay offers additional manufacturing services like 3D printing, PCB assembly and more, making it your one-stop manufacturer regardless if you're a DIY maker, a growing startup or a settled company. Make sure to check out PCBWay for your next project. We users were already able to use paint-on supports, but we had to do it by hand. Now there's an algorithm which cleverly assists us in getting our supports in the right places. And we also can adjust the way it does it by using some sliders, changing the angle which is taken into consideration, and then a button press will be sufficient to get our supports painted on the model. After slicing the model, we see that the supports look quite good and seem to support any aspect of the model which needs support. I also created this model, which I will use later to show the dynamic overhang feature as well, but now it's just to show how the new automatic support feature works. If we slice it with support materials enabled, then we get something like this. Now, if we enable automatic supports painting, you see that there are some areas added to be supported, which makes this large bridge easier to print. We slice it, we can see that the automatic support painter has added these areas to be supported as well. Now let's take a look at the improvements made to the cutting tool, which will save you time and material and thus money. Until now, the cutting tool added a plane parallel to the build plate, which allowed you to cut your model into two pieces. If you wanted to cut your model in a different angle, for example to cut it in a lower and upper part, then you had to rotate your model first and then do the cut. The new tool now allows you to rotate the plane around any of the three axes X, Y and Z, so you can cut your model at any angle you'd like, until you're satisfied with the cut. The white line shows you the seam of the cut, and in the Alpha 4 they also added a different color for the upper and the lower part, so it's much easier to see how your cut will look like. A huge improvement is that you can add connectors to the cut now. They ensure that your printed parts are perfectly aligned when put together. The connectors can be plugs, which are printed fixed to one of the parts, or as dowels, which are printed separately. You can also decide which shape your connector should be. Circle, triangle, square or hexagon are possible. Another choice is if it should be a prism or a frustum, which maybe make it easier to put the parts together. I found cylindrical connectors the easiest, and as frustum it may be even easier to fit the parts. One thing Uncle Jesse mentioned in his video was that the tolerances of the printed connectors makes it hard to fit them. He suggested to scale the connectors, but that isn't necessary. In Alpha 3 you could enter tolerance as percentage value. Now in Alpha 4 they changed the tolerance value to an absolute value, which is much better. So if you know that your printer's accuracy is off by, let's say, a tenth of a millimeter, just enter that in the input field. I also advise to add some more depth to the holes to be on the safe side. It's also possible to flip the cut plane so that the pins are printed on the other side, as I suggested in my feature request I did on GitHub. To flip the plane, just click the button and the connector is added to the other part. There are some options how the parts will be placed on the print platform, which you can check as well. And if you're satisfied with your choices, click on Perform Cut to place your parts on the build platform. Rearrange the parts and you're good to go. If the video already provided some useful information, please give me a thumbs up and subscribe the channel. To see how much time and material we save, I will slice the cut model, and afterwards I will show you, for comparison, the values of the uncut model. Here we can see that the print time for the cut model will be around 8 hours and the material usage is 47.43 grams. We can also see that the support material takes 1 hour and 44 minutes to print. Let's slice the uncut model and see the results. As you can see, the uncut model takes about 9.5 hours to print and has filament usage of about 54.41 grams. We can also see that the print time for the support material is almost doubled. So, when we slice a model and place it intelligently on the build platform, we can save some time, some material and therefore money. The new text emboss tool gives you a smart way to add text to your model without doing it in CAD, which is always a little bit flimsy. So just choose Add Text from the right click menu. Then you see a menu opening where you can enter your desired text. When we look at the text, we see that it's not placed directly on the surface. To change this, click on Use Surface in the menu and you see that it follows the surface of your model. You also can move the text and it will follow the surface as well. And it's possible to rotate the text into another direction. You can choose the font which you want to use for your embossed text. And it's also possible to have it engraved instead of embossed by clicking on Subtracted, and it can also be used as a modifier. When you slice your model, you will see the text embossed into your model. Using the options in the menu, you can change the height, depth, and many other parameters of your text. Play a little bit with the settings to see what you like best. In the next part, you see how I use the embossed text to mark my samples. One of the videos I watched tried to show the difference between the new monotonic lines feature and the already existing monotonic feature, but it came to the conclusion that there was not much difference. I thought that might be because the chosen shape for the test piece was just rectangular. So I decided to make my own test piece, which has some more features, so that I hope to see the difference between the monotonic and the new monotonic lines feature. I also used the text emboss tool to mark my objects so that I can see which one is which later on. I tested the default rectilinear feature, I tested the existing monotonic feature, I tested the monotonic lines feature, and I did that both with ironing turned on as well. First, let's take a look at the tool path for the different features. For the rectilinear surface pattern, the toolhead moves not only in one direction, it changes direction while it's printing the top surface. That introduces some artifacts on the surface. Now let's see how it looks for monotonic. For the monotonic surface pattern, the toolhead moves only in one direction, from right to left or left to right. But it also connects the lines. This is already an improvement for the surface, as we will see when I show you the models. The new monotonic lines surface feature leaves out the connections between the lines, which makes the surface even smoother. Like with a monotonic surface, the toolhead only moves in one direction over the surface, preventing scratches or marks from the toolhead moving over already printed areas. Now let's take a look at the parts and see if monotonic lines make a difference. Here are all five parts next to each other. The lower two parts were printed using ironing. First, the rectilinear part. You see that there are some artifacts on the surface. Next, the part printed with the already existing monotonic feature. This one looks quite better than the rectilinear fill pattern. And now, the new monotonic lines feature. As you can see, it looks almost perfect. Using ironing didn't make things better, but that's because of the embossed text. I guess that there some tweaking is necessary to get that better. Though the surface is still very smooth, it introduced some more material, sharp edges, so I think the best piece is just using monotonic lines, and the surface looks awesome. When I read about the extra overhangs on parameters feature, I first thought about the arc supports, which Stefan from CNC Kitchen showed in a video last year. But the PrusaSlicer implementation looks like a step before that, so I hope we will see real arc supports in a future version of PrusaSlicer. To get them, I use the same part I used to show the automatic paint supports and added some support blockers so that the parts where I want to try out the overhang feature is not supported by automatically generated supports. The feature can be enabled in the print settings. There I check the extra parameters if needed, the extra parameters on overhang, and detecting bridging parameters features. Additionally, I also enable dynamic overhang speeds, which slows down the print speed on overhangs to ensure a better cooling of the overhanging parts and may result in a better print quality, that I should try it out a little bit more, and maybe the bottom finish will look even nicer then. Then I sliced the part and printed it. Let's check what the slicer does when we slice a part. To make the overhang feature work, the tool head starts moving in arcs, getting bigger and bigger, so that each new arc is supported by the previous one. It does so until the whole feature is finished. For the rectangular overhang, it's looking nearly the same. The tool head moves from the inside to the outside, so that each new line can be supported by the previous one. This is a printed part. Looking at the overhang shows that it did very well in the beginning, but suffered at the outer perimeters. The same applies to the rectangular overhang, but altogether it looks very nice. And if you don't have requirements for a very smooth bottom surface, then this can be just useful in some cases. The new organic support feature in PrusaSlicer is what we all have been waiting for. It's an improved version of the already known tree support feature from Ultimaker Cura, and its implementation is based on an algorithm by Thomas Rahm. To enable that feature, go into the print settings, support material enable, generate support material, make sure auto generate supports is enabled as well, then from the drop down select organic as support type. When you select organic supports, it also enables the section organic supports, where you can change some of the settings like the angle or the tip diameter, which may be useful when your model is very large, so that the tip is bigger and supports your model better. Compared to standard supports, using tree support can reduce your print times even further. Here's a print time with standard supports, 9 hours 24 minutes, and the support material takes 3 hours and 27 minutes to print. Slicing the model with tree supports reduces the print time by about 1 hour, and the time we need to print the support material is reduced to 3 hours and 2 minutes. When combined with the cut tool, tree supports can even reduce the print time further. So we see that it's now only 7 hours and 34 minutes, which is about 2 hours less than we had previously. And also the support material takes only 1 hour 44 minutes. This is saving a lot of material and also time and again money. I also found it very easy to remove the tree supports. As you can see, I do it just one-handed while the other hand holds the camera. If you have an SLA printer and use PrusaSlicer to slice your models for your SLA printer, like I showed in one of my previous videos, then you may like the introduction of branch supports, which are an alternative to the default supports, which you could choose in PrusaSlicer by now. Enable them in the print settings by going to the support section and changing the default to the branching experimental support tree type. Then reslice your model. As you can see, you get a new tree support-like structure. Though there's no decrease in print time, since print time is constant and only depending on the number of layers for SLA printers, you save a little bit of material, which can be nice if your resin is very expensive. The last feature I want to show you is a download from printables.com directly into PrusaSlicer. To enable this feature, open PrusaSlicer's configuration, go to Preferences and select the other tab, and there enable Allow Downloads from printables.com. Then you have to go into your Printables account, open your profile, edit your profile, scroll down and activate Show PrusaSlicer button and save the change. When you open a model and go to the files, you will see that there's a new button next to the download button. Click this little button and you will be asked if you want to open the file in PrusaSlicer. And there you are. You have your file directly opened in PrusaSlicer.
Thanks for watching, everyone. I hope you liked the video, and if so, don't forget to give me your thumbs up and also consider subscribing the channel. And also don't forget to check out my library to see my other videos. See you next time!